Hello there, my dear chess lovers and chess friends. In this video, I'm going to show you a tactical pattern, that has served me well, won me a lot of wins in both classical games and blitz games and bullet games alike. So first, we're just going to look at a quick game with white one. It was a hedgehog type setup for black. Go over it quickly. White goes for the move e4 here, that's why he plays rook e1. d4, takes, takes. And everything looks like a normal position for black. He wants to castle and set up what we call a hedgehog structure. But he has to be careful, and in this case, he was not careful about his bishop. And after pawn to e5, he actually has to resign. This will be our pattern, the vulnerable or undefended bishop on b7. And you see these tactical patterns in many lines, and you can apply them in different situations. So you learn it here on b7, but you can also apply them elsewhere, as I will show you. So before looking at examples where I managed to execute this pattern, I want to kind of look at the skeleton, you know, break it down, take a few pieces off the board. So the general pattern is to take advantage of this bishop being undefended and black not being careful. And the way we usually do that is by having a bishop on g2 and opening up a discovered attack on a knight that's standing on f6. Notice that at the start of this, we had these two pawns. So after we play e5, this pawn is actually covering the d5 square. This is important in our pattern, so the knight is not going to be able to play knight d5 and block the diagonal. So black is in trouble because we now have a double attack on the knight and on the bishop. And it's good that there's a bishop on e7, because once we take on f6, the bishop can now not simply retreat, because there's going to be another piece hanging. So we have another double attack. So this pattern is basically executing the undefended bishop on b7, doing a discovered attack, and then a bunch of double attacks, and this wins us material. In the original pattern recognition video series, I did mention this pattern, but I'm gonna expand it a little bit. I have more examples, and I want to add like a little gravy to it, and that's instances where we can play e5, take advantage of this bishop, but also take advantage of the rook behind it. So the key will be the bishop. But what we want to learn is that we can play e5 often without the diagonal being open. We will attack the knight. The knight has to move. Again, if you take, there's going to be take on f6 and take again here. And usually there will be stuff hanging at the end of it. So once the knight moves, we can play knight g5. And that's why we need, I showed you the queen on c2. The queen on c2 is needed here to threaten checkmate on h7. So this means that black must deal with this by taking the knight. And now we can take the bishop, the undefended bishop, the vulnerable little bishop on b7. And behind it, there's a rook, and we are going to win the exchange. Now, usually this will work. There might be some specifics that we have to think about, but very often this will be just a golden pattern. Now let's see a game very similar to the one we had at the start. Again, the English opening, and black does set up the so-called hedgehog defense. Castles, bishop e7, and white plays rook e1. We will see another example where white does not have the rook on e1, and it's important to be aware of these little details and nuances. The rook stands well on e1. If we get our pattern in, because at the end of it, there's not going to be a rook hanging on f1. So this can be important. The rook also, obviously, in this line is just preparing to play e4 here. So e4, and after d6, we have the hedgehog d4. Knight bd7, and this is a blunder. Already black had to do something about the undefended bishop. He had to play probably queen c8 is the best move to avoid any knight b5 stuff. But he played knight b2d7, and many have fallen victim here to this tactic. So no need to be ashamed if you have, but knight bd7 is bad because of e5. And now the ways you can deal with it for black is to take on g2, but as we mentioned, we take on f6 and we have a double attack. If you take on e5, I take on b7. In this case, you can take on d4 and c3, but we are winning the exchange. We're going to back up with our bishop and have the better position. So just one example to show you what I was talking about with the rook on f1. We're going to see another example, a different way to get to the hedgehog. White plays e4 immediately, and now the knight is on e2 instead of f3. Once we take on d4, it wouldn't matter, but here the knight is actually on e2. But here e5 is available, especially since the diagonal is already open. And we are better here, but black gets slightly more compensation because he can take the rook on f1. So at the end of it, we have two pieces for the rook. For rook and a pawn, actually. In the middle game, that's usually beneficial for the two minor pieces, but you always have to take into account what's going on in the position. In this case, it looks quite good for white, and the computer agrees. Now, I have been able to use this pattern to great effect, and I will show you. Now we see a d4 opening, and we're actually going to see the so-called Catalan opening. After bishop d2, knight f3. Many people play b6. This can arise via the Queen's Indian as well, so kind of a Queen's Indian Catalan type of pattern. Knight d5 to open the diagonal here. Black castles, knight g3. And now there are two kind of main moves. I think I even did a recent video where I mentioned, you know, pattern recognition, why it matters, stuff like that, where we had this game, and I won quite easily because I had played this many times before, and yeah, just knew the pattern. I played queen a4, black took on e5, and black is actually losing a pawn here with best play after knight d7. After knight e4, I will take on e4, play rook d1, queen c2, and win the pawn on e4. You can check that yourself, but after knight d7, I want to win this pawn. And I've had many opponents play against me, knight takes e5 here, taking the pawn. Which is a bad move for many reasons, but the main reason is, of course, the pattern that we now already know. Correct, d6, opening of the diagonal, double attack. If you take on d6, I'll take your bishop on b7. And if you take on g2, I'll take on e7. And important at the end of this that we have some kind of an attack, so we can take the bishop next move. So here, white is simply up a piece. Easy win. Now, surprisingly, this pattern can also be important here in case of c6. And I've had several of such games. I mean, these moves are very natural. You can even call this an opening trap in a way. So e4, kind of a standard move in the Catalan. You get castled and you try to open the center with e4, get more scope for your bishop. Knight b to d7. And here, kind of a stunning tactic. Maybe I should have left this as the exercise when I come to think of it. But why to move here? I urge you to pause. You know, try to get active when you're learning, not just, you know, watch and nod along. You know, pause the video and think of the solution yourself. How does white take advantage of our pattern here? I'm assuming you paused it, you came back, and I will not tell you. We will play knight takes e6. Yes, fantastic move. Bishop takes, and now we take on d5. And no matter what black does, we're gonna give this discovery. So takes, takes, bishop b7, there's no other square, this is taken, and then we play d6, and in this case we actually just win a pawn, but it's a good position. We did sacrifice the piece on c6, but still the pattern is useful because we win back the piece, and we're going to be up a pawn. So a move like this, we take on e7, again, attack, so double attack, so we can take the bishop, and we're going to be up a pawn, and moves like this should be safe, and white should be quite good here. So this has given me easy wins in many online games. On we go, more examples. We see many hedgehogs, like we mentioned before. Now something different, the bishop comes to b4. So slightly different. h6, bishop to e3. Note now that the pattern doesn't work. If we play e5 now, black will simply take on g2. And when we take on f6, he can take on f1 or retreat the bishop. It's important to have something attacked on e7. So having said that, I already gave you the trigger. Does it work now? Yes, of course it does. e5. Bishop is undefended. If there was no pawn on c7, this would be okay. We could move the knight. But here, once you take, attack on the queen. Double attack. Win a piece. Two more examples. At least, until it's your turn. Here we have the Queen's Indian. And this is an example of the kind of second, the bonus pattern, having the queen on c2. When you do that, in certain cases, you can get away with e5 without having opened up the diagonal. Like here, there's no immediate attack on the bishop, but e5 is setting up another double attack after knight f to d7. We take on d6. We don't have to do that, it's just more accurate. Black has to react because of the threat. And now we play knight g5, as we mentioned at the beginning. Mid threat and the bishop hanging. Important that the rook is boxed in by the knight. So once black takes this, we're going to take this. And this guy is toast. Toasterino. Yeah, this is very, very similar. I'm not going to go through the opening moves. More or less an example of the same. The queen on c2, undefended guy here. Diagonal not yet open, but we can play e5 here. First, we put the knight on a bad square, h3, knight h6, and then knight g5. Again, the same double attack here. Takes. And white is out the exchange. Finally, even though our pattern mostly applies to the bishop on b7, like I mentioned at the start, this pattern and many other patterns you can apply to like other situations. You can shift things a little bit, you know, up one to the left, down one, etc., etc. So for instance, like an undefended bishop on a8 would mean the same in many lines. An undefended bishop on a6 would mean the same. And this is an example of that. Michael Besold with white against Peter Fröhlich. And very similar. And the game actually ended after one move here. What did white play? He played c5. Double attack. So obviously you can't take on c5. I will take on a6. Take this one. So let's say you try this. Just like taking on g2, I take on f6 in the other line. So same thing. Usually I'm on f6 attacking something. Here I'm on d6 attacking something. This is on g2 and I'm attacking it. Hope I'm not confusing you by mentioning the coordinates from the other original example. But it's the same thing here. Bishop takes e2. And we still keep the double attack because we're attacking this, so we can take on e7. And we're threatening to take with check. So at the end of all of this, the double attacks were in our favor. Note that, yeah, if we take this, we take with check. So again, that's maybe the best line to take on f1. And we keep going with the double attacks. Check. And attack, the double attack. So we win a piece. The same would, of course, apply to knight takes e7 and knight takes e2. So a very nice example to end with. And then I'm going to leave you with a puzzle. And, well, The puzzle is simple. Do you have the ingredients to play e5? Does e5 work in this position? Yes or no? Tell me again, once again in the comments. Will you play e5? Yes or no? And once again, if you like my videos, I would really appreciate if you left a like. It helps me to grow, lets the algorithm know that you like my videos, and also helps me to know that you do appreciate them and gives me the encouragement to keep doing them. We've been pumping out these pattern recognition videos, and I want to keep doing that. So please help me to make that a little more worthwhile. Hope to see you again. Bye bye.